Russia resurrected an older program called Corona, a single stage to orbit vehicle. That and more now on KNews. Hi, Lucas here. Welcome to KNews for week 2 2018. And as always, a big shout out to you, my KNews boosters, on Patreon. Thanks for your thrust. But Corona is not the only news in the rocket department. There were several rocket launches last week, which I don't want to forget. Especially China is at it again, with three ones in a row. The first was a Long March 2D on Tuesday from Taiwan. The second, a Long March 3B on Thursday from Xichang. And another 2D on Saturday from Jiuquan. Up top Long March 3B were two more navigation satellites for their BeiDou 3 navigation system, which will be as usual placed in one of their medium Earth orbital planes at 21,500 km. The rocket was used in its four-stage variant, using an optional upper stage called Yuan Chang, which is literally translated to Far Journey or Expedition. However, I think Far Journey makes a little more sense to me, considering the upper stage allows the rocket to carry a smaller payload to higher orbits. If you happen to be Chinese, please correct me on that. The other two Long March 2D rockets will carry two pairs of Earth-observing satellites, two from type SuperView and one of each LKW-3 and SolySat-5B. These are all relatively small satellites which will be brought into a polar orbit. The next launch took place a little further west in India. Their PSLV rocket or Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle launched on Friday from the Satish Dhawan Space Center. Up top were many different satellites, with the main one being from type Cartosat 2. It has a mass of just over 700 kilograms and will, as the name suggests, be used to help map the world. Basically, an Indian Google Maps, when I understand correctly. The other 30 satellites on board have a combined mass of 600 kilograms and range from communication to weather monitoring. The most interesting one, at least from an outsider's perspective, is one for Japan called CNU Sail 1. It is a solar sail demonstrator, which will demonstrate how to unfold a 2 square meter large sail in space and then use it as a drag sail to re-enter back into the atmosphere. They will basically simulate the sun's radiation pressure using drag to gather data on how the sail behaves to make adjustments to their final design before a bigger and more expensive one is built. Such unfoldable sails could be incredibly useful, especially when it comes to in-orbit station keeping. Right now, satellites have to carry a lot of propellant to stay in the right spot, and this will hopefully change with a reliable sail system. Right now, it's probably a little too risky, since the sail mechanism could simply break, rendering an expensive satellite useless. India's PSLV launched in its biggest XL configuration using the stronger variant boosters, generating a total of 9,000 kilonewtons of thrust. And the last rocket launch is the United Launch Alliance's Delta IV, which launched on Friday as well from Wonderberg. Up top was a top secret spy satellite for the National Reconnaissance Office called NROL 47. But there are some sad news about the launcher, because this was the last Delta IV flight in this particular setup using solid strap-on boosters. The main reason everybody talks about is Atlas V, which is very similar in capability and cheaper. Atlas V launches for roughly 30% less, that's true, but I think such a price difference never really was an issue in the past. Delta IV is cleaner, more efficient and uses engines built in the US. I actually believe the ULA would have much rather retired Atlas V, since they still need Delta IV Heavy and will not start building cores for it anyways. So I personally speculate that it's not Atlas V that killed Delta IV, it's you know who. The competition from private rocket companies really stepped up in the last years, and what we are now witnessing is the beginning of a new space era, where the biggest limiting factor is no longer the availability, but the price. And finally, the most surprising news that came up is Russia's Corona. I've never actually heard about that before, and doing some superficial research, it sounds incredibly interesting, with some neat twists in the rocket design. If you are familiar with reusable rocketry, this shape will immediately remind you of the old Delta Clipper. It was developed for NASA in the early 1990s, and it could launch, maneuver and land back vertically like a Falcon 9 booster, 2 decades ahead of time. There are actually some cool videos online, and I highly recommend to watch it if you haven't seen them yet. The project was sadly cancelled, and I'm not sure why, but I assume budget cuts will have played a big role. The key difference between the Delta Clipper and Corona is the engine. It's an Aerospike. Yes, since this is a single stage to orbit craft, it goes through different regimes on its way to space, and as the atmospheric properties change, the engine usually doesn't. Now, in order to follow, you have to know a rocket engine works like this. The rocket fuel mixes and ignites in the engine's combustion chamber, where a very high pressure is created. The atmospheric pressure is around the engine, and it is, of course, much lower. A fundamental property of how fluids and gases behave is that pressures mix and even themselves out. Doing this, the engine exhaust leaves the nozzle and expands in all directions almost equally, like a semisphere. Shooting out the back, not violating any laws of physics, the rocket has to shoot in the opposite direction as a result of that. Yay, thrust! To maximize the thrust gains, an engine bell is used to direct more of the exhaust backwards and not to the sides. But the exhaust does not expand infinitely within the atmosphere because the exhaust pressure reaches the atmospheric one at some point. This is where the engine bell should end. No more is needed. Now the problem is, going to space, the atmospheric pressure decreases towards zero, and since the typical engine bell cannot grow, the rocket loses thrust efficiency on the way up. Now don't confuse this with the exhaust speed efficiency from KSP. The total thrust still increases as it goes up, but it could increase even more, and this is exactly the issue the Aerospike engine fixes. It has a variable engine bell, which changes during flight, but it's not a physical one you can touch. To understand this, you have to know that an engine bell is not the only way to redirect the exhaust backwards. Instead of using a normal nozzle, where the exhaust expands in every direction, you can also simply shoot the exhaust towards an inverted engine bell, the spike. The effect is the same, the exhaust is redirected downwards, producing thrust. Now, the spike alone does not fix the problem. It has a fixed size and had to change its length during flight, similar to a bell. This is where aerodynamics come into play and where it gets incredibly complicated. However, the basics are relatively simple. The spike is truncated into a stump, making it much shorter and lighter. Now, as the hot exhaust rushes past this stump, the ambient air gets caught, filling the gap. A very strong whirl forms, and guess what this whirl does? Yep, it creates an aerodynamic spike or aerospike out of gas because it can't go anywhere. The whirl motion is the very important part here that allows energy or momentum to be transferred from behind the engine to the stump. It creates a push basically. A very neat thing about this aerospike is that it continuously adapts to changes in the air pressure around the engine and always maintains the perfect shape at all stages of flight. Russia's Corona is supposed to use such a large aerospike engine, which consists of many tiny thrusters firing at the truncated aerospike. However, it is unknown how far into development the rocket is, and I don't expect it to fly anytime soon. It's a little speculative, but the weird shape of it could be an indication that the whole thing is meant to re-enter and therefore looks like a stretched capsule. The final design could still look very different, and I will of course keep you updated on future developments. But tell me what you think about the whole concept. Is Russia serious? Will they catch up when it comes to reusability? And now that Delta 4 is gone, who do you think will be next? Okay, that shall conclude this week's episode, and I hope to see you next one if you like. Auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching.